Good day to you all. In the series on the negative series impedances, I want to go deeper into how it maybe can be done to have less losses in the pulse that we send out from our motor coil. So if this is our motor and it gives the negative pulses, then we have several impedances before we go to the battery, as we can see in the document of Rick Friedrich. So we have the motor coil and we have series impedances, and then we go to the battery, and then from the battery we are going back to the plus R of the motor. So to have the least amount of losses, the impedance should be the same if we go to another coil. At least that is what I think at the moment. I'm not completely sure, I'm not an expert. So I'm starting from this diagram and I'm hoping to get it work better so that I don't have losses when I add more impedances, because that is now the case. The system on itself works, but every time I add a load or an impedance, then indeed there is more sent back to the motor also, but the influence is that every time I add a load, the other load is going, when it's an LED, it goes dimmer. So that is what I am trying to avoid, and this video series is the first step I'm taking to solve that, or try to solve that problem. So if this is the pulse that we send and we come to our first impedance, then if we have a same impedance over the whole length, then the pulse will not diminish. On the other hand, when there are differences, then we get reflections every time we are coming to that new impedance, and we are getting back reflections. And a second problem that we then have is that the amplitude is not that high anymore, and every time it goes further, it goes dimmer and dimmer. So that is what I am going to try to avoid. Now, this part of the videos up until now is not including the back EMF of these coils, because once the pulse goes through it, then we are going to have a reaction of this coil also. But it's enough complicated at the moment to try and understand only the first pulse that goes through, that I'm going to leave that part out for later. So only thinking what I can do to make this pulse arrive over here with the less amount of losses. So in the DVD 7 of Energy of the Vacuum, also talked about by Rick Friedrich, at a certain moment Bedini drew a coil, and he said that we need to have to create a node across that coil. Now, it's not clear to me if the top value of that node should be in the middle of the coil or at the beginning, so that we have, if take for example, if this is 100 volts, that we have 100 volts here and 0 volts over there, or that we have 0 volts over here, 100 volts over here and 0 volts over there. That is also something that I'm not sure about. So if we look at electricity and it moves, then we are speaking of the speed of light when it goes through air, which means that we are having a speed of 300 million meters per second. So if we go and look, if we have for example a pulse of 1 megahertz, then this length in air should be 300 meters. Now, the 300 meters is a complete sine wave. Now we are only going to work in pulses. So if we divide the length into 4, then it takes 75 meters for that first amplitude. So from the beginning to the first amplitude is then 75 meters. So if our coil is that length, then we have on both sides of the coil a voltage difference at the maximum. So this is what I mean, the response is the back EMF of that coil. Now I was trying to do some experiments and to see what is the velocity factor if we are talking about our coils. Meaning I want to determine if I send a pulse through this system, how much time does it take when the pulse arrives here to here? Because it will determine the length of wire that we need if we want to go 1/4 of a wavelength to have the full amount of voltage across it. So I came to information about delay lines, and that is going to be later in this video. I'm now going to first start with this. So this is my setup at the moment. I have the function generator. It has a 50 ohm resistor. Then I'm going to transformer over here. And these are the two secondary windings of that transformer. Now I'm letting the signal and the ground go through the coils. The reason for that is, and I will show it on the scope, when I only let the pulse go through this coil and I measure it, then it will go directly. But only when this coil is also inserted and we create a capacitance between the two coils, we have a delay on our signal. So this is what we are now seeing on the scope. So the yellow line is the pulse I sent in, and the blue line is the return at the end. So so this is channel 1. So I sent here the pulse, and here it arrives at the other 50 ohm end resistor. So the end resistor over here is a 50 ohm that is normally made to put on a function generator and so on. So this is the 50 ohm resistor, and I can show you the difference. It's not that easy to... So this is without that 50 ohm resistance, and we get that sending back of the signal, the reflection. So now I'm going to try and put it again on. It's not easy with one hand. So now it's back on. So we see that indeed we are measuring the right way, because we can see the reflection if the impedance is not correctly. And that is also what is shown over here. So if the impedance is not the same or not rightly ended at the end, then we get the reflection. So that is why in the previous movie I want to go into the impedance of the battery, because we need to know the impedance of the battery to not have that influence that we just saw on the pulse that we put in, because it's not only the output that is changed but also the input, as you can see. Also, our input signal is influenced by what we have on the reflection. And if this goes through a second impedance, then this is the input signal of that impedance, so that is also not correctly. So I will zoom out just a little to give you an idea on the signal when there are more. So you don't see it when you zoom out, it's only when you zoom in that you see the difference of the 50 ohm resistor. I'm going back to try to connect it. I should find a better way to do it. Going to set the camera on pause and then I'm come back to it. So here we are back. Now I'm going to show you what happens if we leave out the coil at the bottom, so that we don't have a capacitive influence with our signal. So going to disconnect scope. And as you can see, it is not good at all, because our signal is really changed. So this is what we get on our output when we don't put in that second coil. And also when we look at there is no delay. You see that this is where it goes, the pulse goes in, and on the output you immediately see the change, so we don't have a delay. So therefore I think that the capacitance is the influence why we have that delay on that coil. And important that that I think also is that when we have that delay, then it's also possible to not have influence on the input signal if our impedances are at the right are matched, better say that. So I never understood why in an if you look at some of Akula on the internet, where he has that LED power, and you look at the coils, then in one of the setups there was a shield, but it was not closed and it was grounded. So I didn't understand that why it should be used. But now I can, I think I can imagine why, because in this way we are creating a capacitance to ground and we are creating a delay. So I looked at the internet for delay lines and I only found closed loops, meaning closed tubes. But I think it's better, like in some of the designs mentioned, that it is not closed to prevent eddy currents created in those capacitive plate in this case. What a phase shift is and so on, I don't know, between voltage and current. So that is something I need to try and find out, but it is not measurable with my equipment at these low levels. So that is something that I will need to do when I have the motor connected. So this is what I want to show you in this movie. There is one thing I didn't understand, is why if you need 75 meters for the pulse, then that would be extremely long coils. So I think the velocity factor is very important. And in the whole system over here, if we want our pulse to go the best way to our battery, then all impedances must be matched. But if we want to place a load, then we have to have some kind of delay. I have to say it's just what I think. I'm not sure, I'm not an expert. But it is that delay that is going to give us the node that we want on that coil. Then of course we need to look into matching the coils of our loads with the coils that are in series with our transmitting line. Maybe there is another way, because I'm still doubting on the fact if we place impedances in series like here, are we creating, if these are 10 ohms each, do we have an impedance of 40 ohms, or do we have, because we are working with pulses, 10 ohm, 10 ohm, 10 ohm, 10 ohm. That's something also that I'm going to try to give you an answer to in this video series. So another part that I want to add to this video is When we look at the sine wave and the reason why we need or should best use 1/4 of a wavelength is that when we send a pulse and it's going to there, then you see the moment when we are going at the beginning on the pulse, we have the maximum over here. So if this is our coil, we have much maximum voltage between the beginning and the end of our coil. Also, when we go further, we have a maximum between beginning and end of our coil, and also further away. Now, in our system, this is the pulse that we send, and this will be later on the return of that other coil in the system. So that will be the return of this coil, because when we look at the motor, we send a pulse, so it's positive over here, because it's the inverse of what is we that of what we have given over here. But if this pulse is passed through the coil, then this magnetic field is also going to collapse, and we are going to have a reaction also in that way. So that will be then the part over here. But as you can see, with 1/4 of a wavelength of the coil, we always have maximum voltage. Also, when we send in a pulse, so if we send a pulse and we have 1/4 of the wavelength, but in this case the time for the pulse to go from minimum to maximum, then we have maximum voltage of the on the coil. If our time should be shorter, then we have the problem that we are not going to have maximum voltage between beginning and end of our coil. Now, what I don't know is, am I looking at this at the right way? Meaning, if the pulse is coming, do we have enough on the pulse going through the system to have a voltage difference across it? Because we have, of course, the rate of change, and that is going to give you a spike. Are we only working off that spike, or do we need to look further and look to the pulse, like I said, in this way? It's difficult to explain what I have in my mind, I have to be honest on that. But I hope I'm clear enough. So, hope to see you in the next movie, and hope I could somehow make you understand what I'm meaning. Thank you.